When I first got here, Spokane was a small town. It was basically just like a glorified truck stop. Maybe about 1,000 people, just a few city blocks. 20 years later, Spokane's got over 4,000 people. It's a county seat. It would take you 20, 25 minutes to walk from side to side. First got here, there was no way to store rainwater other than collecting it out of ponds that the government dug out using tractors. That was the way they helped people. And we started building the cisterns back in 2002 to help people collect rainwater that fell on the roofs. And since then, we've built over 415 now. And those have made huge changes in the lives of the families in about 14 different villages. The health situation for each family improves considerably. Less diarrhea, less trips to the doctor, less medications for that. So that's a money saver, a time saver. You don't have mothers and kids having to go out to fetch water. Regularly in the afternoon, you see moms and kids going out with wheelbarrows to collect 30, 40 gallons of water. That's a lot of work. So with these cisterns, you don't have that as much. We build about 30 or 40 cisterns a year. But it really adds up. When you think about it, we're at nearly 5 million gallons of stored rainwater annually. It's pretty impressive what these folks have been able to do working together. That the Presbyterians that we worked with that were in charge of this project, like guys like Victor, Raul, and others, have just really embraced it and taken it beyond the Presbyterian Church. And it's spread to over a dozen villages and families that come from all different kind of faith backgrounds, including no faith. Build the cisterns, the people that are going to have the cisterns are building it themselves, so there's a real interest in doing things the right way or as best as they possibly can. What we build out of love and compassion, just people building for themselves, for their neighbors. There's a caring there and a concern and a real pride in workmanship because it needs to be that way. It begins with a face-to-face talk. If you want to be involved with our cisterns, you need to just actually start talking to somebody, talking to our foreman, and talking to owners to get an idea of what our project is. So it's born in a relationship, and that just ramps up as you get to the preparation stage, and then the building phase. And then afterwards, the relationship continues, because these people can't afford their cisterns. So what they do is basically we give them a loan. They don't have any signed contracts. We don't have any interest payments to force people to pay faster. We just entirely use a sense of gratitude. And so relationship is so important for us. Without that gratitude, there is no continuity. There is no follow-up. There is no continued relationship between partners. Otherwise, everyone's just like, okay, I got my cistern, and that's it. That's what you'll see with a government project. With us, it's a relationship that continues. We've had people that have been making payments on their cisterns for more than 7 years. The money that they repay, the secret is, we reinvested in them. We know what we have is necessary. We know people need it. We know it changes lives. And we're confident, and we pray for it actually, that people will find us. And it all begins with a face-to-face conversation, and it continues with face-to-face conversation. Our hope is that as the repayments continue and as these groups come together every year to make repayments or whenever, they'll get a stronger and stronger sense of community, a stronger sense of we can do bigger things. As long as I've been living in Shrewsbury, trying to promote the church and all their efforts to reach more people, because obviously that's the most important thing in a person's life. And sometimes I think in America we forget about that. The most important thing, the first thing that has to come first is your relationship with the Lord. And I love people having the opportunity to come down here and see people actually living that way. When you come down on a mission trip, you really kind of get right up close and personal to people for a week or two, and really gives you the chance to see how different people live their faith, very differently than we did back in the States. If you want your life to be changed, I think you need to experience this. I really believe the Holy Spirit wants to work through our brothers and sisters in Mexico to help open eyes and open hearts to creating deeper relationship with Jesus Christ. It's a two-way street. We're not just giving something to them and working for them. They also are giving us and filling us with examples and experiences that we can take back with us by getting outside of your own cultural context, getting out of your comfort zone. There's a lot to learn. For people that aren't sure if a mission experience is for them, I've heard someone give the advice, just go. Come and see. Just go. Taste and see. Experience it. I can't convince you from the pulpit or with the PowerPoint presentation the way the Holy Spirit can work in your life if you do something like this. But see if you don't see the Spirit moving. See if it doesn't draw you closer to Christ, even after your trip, and change your life. I've seen it again and again and again. It can happen to anyone. God will find you where you are in your life, and He can work through these faithful people that you'll come in contact with down in Mexico. So try it and see what happens.